So good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining for this particular webinar. First, to introduce the National Institute of Tourism and Hospitality Management is established in the year 2004 jointly by the Government of India and the Government of Telangana. So we offer both master and bachelor level programs. In bachelor level programs, we have a BBA in Tourism and Hospitality. And BSc in hotel management, and we have a master's in tourism and hospitality management. So apart from these full-time programs, we do have a certificate programs and consultancy services and other training programs. So coming to this particular, the webinar, you all know that, the global outbreak of COVID-19 has brought the world to a standstill, and tourism has been the worst affected of all major economic sectors. Against this particular backdrop of heightened turbulence and uncertainty, up-to-date and reliable information and initiatives are more important than ever. So both for the stakeholders, particularly for academic, it is very important. Particularly for the students, those who are aspirants of the tourism and hospitality, it is important to know what is happening in the industry and how we are going to deal with this particular issue. So considering this particular aspect, NITIM, National Institute of Tourism and Hospitality Management, is conducting a four-day webinar series on post-COVID-19 and tourism and hospitality industry, survival or revival. So in this particular backdrop, we have a sub-themes, particularly, the challenges in and opportunities in facilities management and in tourism and hospitality, and also in the MICE. So on this series, yesterday we have conducted on facilities management, and now we are going to have a tourism related the discussion. So for this particular program, the webinar, we have three speakers, the eminent speakers, Mr. Siraj Ansari and Mr. Harikishan Valmiki, and we have Ms. Vandana Vijay. So before going to start the session, I would just like to give a brief, the introduction about, the speakers. Starting with Mr. Siraj Ansari. Mr. Siraj Ansari is a founding president of Tour Operators Association of Telangana, and is the director for Avian Holidays, and is having over 28 years of experience in tourism. Particularly, in the tour operators and the consultancy services. And coming to his educational qualification, is having a master's in tourism management. Apart from that, he's also having a MBA. The next speaker is Mr. Valmiki Harikishan. Good afternoon, sir. Thank you for joining. I can see you. So he's the founder and managing partner and executive director of Valmiki Travel and Tourism Solutions. He is also the director for Valmiki Foundation. Earlier, he worked in various organizations like Recall Travel and Yatra, TripGoTrip.com, and he is also chairman for Tourism Wing, particularly the Tourism and MICE Committee of Federation of Telangana and Andhra Pradesh Chambers of Industries and Commerce. He is also director for Young Scholar International Program, and he is also graduated in Commerce and having a diploma in Tourism Studies from Pondicherry University. Then we have a third speaker, Ms. Vandana Vijay. She is CEO and founder of Upbeat Tracks, and she's also a TED speaker and Facebook employee. She's also an All Indian UPSC first rank holder, and particularly this organization, the Upbeat Tracks, more of into experiential and sustainable travel, where they are more committed towards achieving the sustainable developmental goals. So in this particular regard, I would like to request Mr. Siraj Ansari sir to speak few words about the tourism industry, and what are the issues and challenges that we are going to face, and how the students should be equipped with the the career and all. So I request Siraj sir.
Hi, good afternoon to all, and it's a good opportunity to interact with most of the aspiring personalities of the future. And Nitin has been doing a wonderful experience in getting a lot of people trained and placing them in the best of the companies. Because I've been associated with them for a few years, and I really appreciate the exclusive support they've been doing for the industry. Now, but to be honestly, the situation is very, very critical right now, and it's a global issue which I think most of the people in the industry have been going through this in a very bad way. But I always suggest that we always leave with the hope. And it is just a matter of a few months, probably we would be able to come back to action. We'll be back to the same way of operations, but with a little amendment of business. Well, the tourism industry has to fight back in a much effective way with a more organized segments where we could be focused on the right direction. And we see a wonderful where people can go diversify to different aspects of tourism. We have multiple options, but most people are unaware of that. And that is something which is going to happen now. And we have many options which we'll share to you probably later. And the idea is that all of you should not lose hope right now. Just be consistent in your efforts and ensure that we revive back in a more effective manner. And all those drawbacks on the flaws, whatever is there in there,
you are not audible, Siraj bhai, unmute.
Okay. I don't remember where I left it, but I just start off with a few things. Well, I feel is we have an opportunity in the industry which can be revived back with the consistent efforts and with the good eminent personalities. We would really be able to revive back in a much effective manner. And the industry, I suggest, is just on a stagnated for a moment. For a few weeks, or I would say a few months now, but it will revive back in full force and with a lot of aspiring personalities who are striving the best in the aviation industry, in the hospitality, in the tourism industry. Things are going to be much different after a couple of weeks. I'm not talking about years. I said a couple of weeks from now. Things have to refine because we have to survive. And the question is whether survival is the first or the revival is the first. The logic is that we have to ensure that we together be able to achieve what we deserve. So that's what is the ideology, what I feel has to be implemented right now for the industry. And what are the drawbacks and flaws we have that has to be revived back? And we have to ensure that we have more quality of trainings, very exclusive personalities who can change the industry in a much more professional manner. That's what I feel personally is required. If you have any other options of the industry, I would suggest is tourism is and hospitality is still a wonderful options because you have wonderful global careers which are very effective for the long run. But most people are a little upset the way it's happened because the government support was not there for the tourism industry. But I'm sure it is going to revive back after some time. So that's it. I would just like to ask others also to share their opinions on this. I think Mr. Valmiki is there to just share a few more information on this. Valmiki, are you able to hear?
Yes.
Hello, sir. Yeah, please share your insights, sir.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon to you all. Very happy to be online with Nidham students and highly appreciate the efforts of Nidham management, Chinnam Reddy and Mahendra. You're doing a great job. This is actually need of the hour to motivate our future leaders. If the social distancing is distancing us, but still we have an option where we can always unite each other and share more knowledge and so that we all grow together. So coming to the topic today, yes, I do understand today the most negative word is the positive. The moment the blood test is positive, you're got people. So let's keep that aside now because yes, whether you make a phone call to somebody or whether you fine tune to any TV channel, everywhere the fear. So we academicians, especially the students, need not worry because you got such a wonderful opportunity this kind of a situation comes as the historian's knowledge every 100 years once. So you all must be luckiest people to witness such a long gap where you can spend more quality time with yourself. Because in today, this corporate society or the corporate world, we are running and we are not spending quality time with ourselves or with our loved ones. So this lockdown is definitely teaching a lot of lessons. So from every situation of negativity, you can always learn, because the moment you start looking in the positive side. So coming to the industry, you need not, upset about what's happening, whether there is a future or not. Are we going to, survive, or as Siraj said, whether survive is important or revival important, whether is there any opportunities we'll get or not. All these things, I want you all to just keep it aside. Don't even give a second thought to worry about your future. You are still, I'm telling you, in a correct industry, a right industry. Because today the travel, hospitality, tourism has become a part of a life. It's no more a luxury. Gone are those days when a flight ticket is affordable only the luxury people. Now every common man can fly. So after this Zoom and Zomato or Swiggy, they taught the people to eat outside food weekly thrice or four times. So people have become, they made it as a part of their life. So restaurants, hotels, everybody will come back in a much, much bigger way, the way we have been losing these many days. But once the industry opens up, we will bounce back 3 to 4 times bigger than what we were yesterday. Because see, the industry by nature, the tourism as an industry in nutshell, whether it is travel, hospitality, tours, all put together in nutshell, when you call it as a tourism as an industry, it has got a nature. By nature, it is a resilience in the industry. So what do you mean by resilience industry? It has got the tenacity to come back on its own. You don't need the government to come and push. You don't need academicians to come and push. You don't need stakeholders like us to come and push. It has got its own importance, role. It will come back. But only thing is, you have to have patience. As long as you continue with your passion, patience will be automatically, becomes one of your attitude. So what my urgent request to all the students, during this time, since you are finding good quality time, instead of letting your mind to talk about the negativity, what's happening in the world, talk about all the challenges, start thinking about something innovative, start learning. Because all these days we have been learning. There is another button called unlearn. So how do we unlearn what we learned, which is not necessary today? How we can relearn? See, these are the new mantra today. Learn, unlearn, and relearn. So these three mantras, the student have to keep it in mind, that whether it is hospitality industry or any other industry, we should not stop learning, unlearning, and relearning. So the moment you say, I started earning so that my learning can stop, but that is not a scenario. From womb to tomb, I always say, from womb to tomb, you never stop learning. Because now what is COVID teaching us? What is Corona teaching us? There are so many things that this pandemic is teaching us. When September 11 attacks took place, when terrorist attacks took place, when the way hotels have tightened the security. Earlier those days, there was not much security. Why are there is a sniffer dog at the entrance of a gate? Why do you need scanning of a person who is entering into the hotel? Because of those terrorist attacks, they wanted to safeguard. So every incident is teaching a lesson and adopting certain new systems. Why are we going to airport 1 hour before, or 2 hours before, now 3 hours before? Now sanitation has become a primary role now. Sanitation is another security threat now. So now hotel industry, when it comes, I remember when I was a student, it was a better breakfast. I remember BB basis. So after B, the 2B has become 3Bs. What is the 3Bs? Bed, breakfast, and broadband. Now with this COVID, now it has become 4Bs. What do you mean by 4Bs? Bed, breakfast, broadband, being safe. Is the customer being safe if he checks into your hotel? Is the customer safe if he enters into your restaurant? Is the student is safe, he enters into Nidham campus? So all this really matters. How much measurements you are taking, whether you are following the social norms like WHO norms, the social distancing, being hygiene, you know, all these methods are we adopting? Because in a country like India, where there's a huge population and the density is more, so social distancing is definitely a challenge. But as far as possible, students have to start learning this and definitely adopt. And our industry definitely is going to come back, even though the government of India could not able to figure out any kind of a relief package or bailout package for the industry. You don't need to worry. I was told by somebody that my voice is not audible. Is it okay now? I have just increased my voice button. Is it audible now?
Yes, sir. Audible.
Okay, somebody sent a message.
That was long back, I think. The message.
Yeah. So, students, I really wanted to give you one mantra today, how you can gear up or, you know, rather I can say mentally prepare. You know, when you enter into an aircraft, when an air hostess says, fasten your seat belts, this is a high time for all of us to fasten our seat belts to go to a new era, new world. Definitely tourism industry is coming back. We need, so just see the example today, when the lockdown is uplifted in a partial manner, now people wanted to start their business, there is no labor available, all labor left to both states. So the similar situation should not come into the industry. Once the industry comes into normal stage, all the industry students or employees leaving, industry and going away to different sectors, it is not the right practice. As it is today, if you ask me, the industry is already lack of employees in the both travel, tourism, and hospitality industry. We are already having acute shortage. So if these kind of challenges fears you and make you a decision not to continue and step out, this the problem will increase further, because there is a demand. Definitely the supply is need to be filled with the gap of the institutes like NITAM. They're trying their best to encourage more people enter into the industry. And definitely you need to tell others and you need to take it in a positive manner. Yes, this is a stop gap. It is not only meant for Telangana or India. Whole world is undergoing this scenario. So there is no anything wrong with the industry. There is no anything wrong with the institute. There is no anything wrong with your career chosen. Only thing is the entire world is under regeneration. Let us take it as that the world is getting regenerated. The birds are coming back into the place. Animals are having gala time. So the nature is getting purified, ozone layer also getting it into normal shape. So why don't you think in that manner? You got a chance to spend more quality time with your loved ones. My son got a shock that am I going to continue stay at home but 24/7? Yeah, I mean, I'm telling you, we are making it, certain dreams come true. And how much time you spend quality time with you. Now I'm able to spend time about me. I'm trying to understand the unique personality in the world is that is you. So try to spend quality time with you and try to understand, maybe adopt some new, diplomas or, maybe new courses or, there's so many things available online. So the digital weapon is available today. All that you need is a simple Wi-Fi and a laptop. You just get connected and you'll get lost. You will be definitely going through browsing, learn. Now our stakeholder, our industry colleague Siraj, he is busy educating, empowering, nothing he's doing. He's bringing all the stakeholders from every nook and corner of the world and bringing them on one common platform, educating the stakeholders. They're not students, they're travel agents, they already know. I've gone to Israel, but still yesterday we had a wonderful discussion on Israel as a topic. So we have got very good industry stakeholders who are really looking selflessly, working hard for the welfare of stakeholders and the students' welfare. Today we are all spending quality time, at least 1 hour we are going to spend. I'm sorry, I may, Mahendra, just alert me if I cross my time.
Yeah, you have time, so you have.
So friends, please don't get panic. Mantra, what I learned recently, how it is important to face the present challenges and take forward. I would like to tell, somebody said, repeat 4 B's. I really don't know what you mean by 4 B's, but I've got 4 Q's to be taught today. We all know IQ. IQ means intellectual questions. You have to ask all these questions, you have to ask yourself. So one is IQ. IQ stands for intellectual question, right? The second one is EQ. Have you all heard about anything EQ? EQ is very important. EQ is emotional question. Then the third question you have to ask yourself is PQ. PQ is physical question. The fourth one is SQ. As per airline terminology, SQ is Singapore Airline, but for us, SQ stands for spiritual question. So daily, I want every student ask these four questions yourself from the day you get up from the bed and when you hit the bed. Because these four cues will make you more stubborn or more, proactive and be positive all the time. And you accept however life turns. You will never have a chance for regretting anything that could have happened. So let us talk about the PQ. PQ is physical question. So what is physical question? How physically strong are you? Are you looking older than your age? Or are you looking younger than our age? Mahinder looks always like a student for me. I don't know how old is Mahinder. There are so many, hospitality industry is an enterprising industry. I may not be fully dressed, but as long as you guys need to view me, I have to show my passion towards my industry. Whether I'm wearing a Bermuda below or a pant doesn't matter. But how you appear matters for the industry stakeholders. The passion lies how you dress up. And physical exercise is really required. When I say PQ, physical question is nothing but make daily morning physical exercise is very, very much important. Be strong enough and, strong enough to handle the situations. Now, next is, I can say IQ, intellectual question. Intellectual question, anyway, it's all somebody inborn genes, DNA, somebody want learning from the institutes, how you can handle the questions or problems you encounter, how much intellectually you can think, solve the problems, situations. So IQ levels is really important. It comes from your childhood days, the way you are mentored by your teachers and institute stakeholders. And when it comes to EQ, EQ is very, very important, especially after you become an entrepreneur or an employee. EQ is emotional question. What do you mean by emotional question? Emotional question is nothing but how fast you get angry. So the anger is always on our nose, right? I come from Rayalaseema. Rayalaseema people will have more anger. They are very angry. They eat a lot of spicy stuff. It doesn't matter whether you eat only sweets, you are soft as such, nothing as such. Now, how long you can control your anger really matters. But how do I know, sir, whether I have angry or not? The angry bird is there with everybody. Now they made a beautiful movies out of Angry Bird where people can laugh. But how you convert this anger into, relaxation mode is really important. But how do I check, sir, whether I have, the angry quality with me or not? When you're talking, you watch yourself, how fast you get angry. The moment you get angry, that means your emotional level, your EQ levels are low. So in the industry called hospitality industry, you have to be always smile on your face. There is no chance for you to get anger or anybody. So because we are in an industry called service industry. So EQ levels to be maintained, like how you check your BP, you please also check your EQ level. The moment you get anger, your emotional levels are weak. So try to come out from that angry kind of a nature where the meditation is a good mantra. Start learning, adopting some meditation classes. Now, I don't recommend go to some particular center as such. Even if you sit quite calmly, spend quality time with you yourself is called meditation. When I'm talking to you also, I'm doing meditation. It's nothing but focusing or concentrating on what you're talking is nothing but meditation. So when you're concentrating on one particular topic is called meditation. You don't require to sit before an idol or sit in a dark room or a soothing music. Of course, there are so many options available. Whatever will give you comfortness, you follow it up. But end of the day, meditation will control your anger. Then the last one is SQ. What is SQ? Spiritual question. I'm not talking about connecting you to the God or, dealing on religious system as such. SQ is nothing but spiritual question. Why are you trying to say this word? So for example, from Nidham, there are two top chefs Nidham has produced. Both are earning very well and both are having beautiful restaurants and equally earning very well. Both are busy. One has got SQ, the other one does not have SQ. How do you classify that? One gentleman who is thinking about the health of a customer and making dishes in a healthy point of view and producing good recipes and making money. The other gentleman does not care about the health of a customer. He, all that he wants is to do business, to earn more. He's giving all the junk food, whatever that can tempt people, and he's also earning. So who is lacking SQ here? The guy who is running with the junk food, no, not bothered about the health of a customer. But here the other fellow is worried about the customer equally and also serving this. Both are working hard. Both are working 12 hours per day. But end of the day, both are earning same. But SQ levels matters. That means whatever you are doing, end of the day, keep the customer welfare in your mind. So these four Qs are very, very important, which I come across very recently, very valid. So learning is definitely never to get stopped. These challenges will definitely, we are coming through. And this industry, I'm telling you, it is a part and parcel of everyone's life. How important to have a family doctor, how important to have a family lawyer, that important to have a family travel consultant now after pandemic situation. Because people now understand which country is safe to travel. Now, why are we still taking yellow fever vaccination when you travel to Africa? Because they found that there is a vaccine available so that you don't get malaria or other kind of problems when you go to this African country. Similarly, for this kind of COVID, there will be a vaccine coming soon. Then people will get addicted to it, and maybe when they start traveling, they might have to take the vaccine and they start traveling. So similarly, restaurants also will show themselves how safe they are. Then they win the confidence of a customer, then they'll come back. So just keep wait, watch, and I'm sure things will get all right. And meanwhile, when you are free, please try to utilize every single opportunity and start learning. Thank you so much. Hope I did my best to give you a short capsule break. Thank you, Mahendra.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for sharing your opinion and suggestions. The question was from Rajesh. Actually, he repeated you to, I think you mentioned three B's, not four B's. It was about bread and breakfast, and the third one you mentioned is broadband. Yeah, okay. Just for the clarity. Okay.
The fourth B is being safe.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Safe, and this is accepted and adopted by the hospitality fraternity. So now they are going to technically use this 4B terminology.
Okay.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Ms. Vandana Vijay to share her insights about, particularly related to the sustainable and responsible tourism, how she is engaged in this particular area, and particularly in this field, how the career is going to be there for the travel and tourism students. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, Mr. Mahendra Reddy. First of all, I'd like to thank you to provide me with this platform and opportunity to connect and interact with students. And it's an honor to be on the same panel with Mr. Siraj Ansari and Valmiki ji, two people whom I look up to and take a lot of mentorship from. So as you mentioned, I'd like to talk a little about how I believe that ecotourism and sustainable travel are going to be the new future of travel. There'll be a great trend in people migrating and adopting this mode of travel in the post COVID-19 era. So to begin with, there are a lot of skeptics we come around in the world today who say that, the future of travel is over, travel's not going to happen. And students, let me assure you that do not get demoralized by this. Remember that the innate urge to travel is human. It is a fidgety, irresistible urge that all of us humans have had right from the evolution of mankind. If you talk about the great migration which happened of humankind from the continent of Africa to the great conquest which happened across the history of the earth to space exploration, which Tesla does now as the final frontier, then urge to travel and explore our surroundings is something which is innately human, and come what may, no matter what hindrance comes, that is not going to die. So please remember, this industry is here, it has been there, and it will go on to exist till posterity, because people will want to travel, will want to explore. And the importance for us is to constantly reinvent ourselves and move ahead with the times. As they say, change is the only constant. And as long as we keep reinventing ourselves with the need of the times and the era forward, nothing is going to stop us. Now, little bit about ecotourism. Since all of you know what ecotourism is, since you are from the industry, I can be a little more technical here. And we are focusing on travel which is very sustainable, does not abuse nature, which is very immersive, and has a huge focus on impact on local communities. I personally believe that travel as a medium should be something that should, you know, have you sensitize every sense of yours beyond just your sense of sight, where you go to a particular place, visit a tourist spot, click your pictures for your Instagram and Facebook. Travel has to be something which is much more than that. You can invigorate your sense of smell, your sense of sight, your sense of taste. Every part of your well-being needs to be invigorated through travel. I personally believe that travel is a great teacher, is a phenomenal teacher for everybody. The moment you as an individual get out of your comfort zone, get exposed to a new culture, a new form of life, a new landscape, there is so much all of us can learn from those experiences, and travel needs to be that medium by which we connect with the rest of the world. They say the world is a universal family. You know, in Indian culture, we talk about the concept of Vasudeva Kutumbakam. And I really feel travel and exploring new cultures and interacting with people from around the world is the perfect medium by which we can fulfill this whole dream of Vasudeva Kutumbakam. Now, few things which I feel will become very important in the future of travel, and things which we in the industry would necessarily have to mandate. Number one is safety. When we talk about safety, there are two things that come into mind. One is safety in reality. That is, you know, safety checks are met, health parameters are met. The other aspect is safety in perception. In a lot of cases, people need to perceive and be mentally reassured that yes, travel is fine. It's okay to travel to a particular destination. I can probably use this for travel and transport. So safety in reality and perception, which will take some time to come, but will definitely happen. Now health, Mr. Valmiki has very nicely elaborated on health and its importance. I'm just going to give you a brief on that, saying mandatory checks would be issued by governments, private bodies, local authorities to ensure that safety parameters and checks are being met for the safety of the individuals and community at large. Hygiene, again, is something which is going to be very important, and I feel is a blessing in disguise for India, because we'll have a great bunch of health and hygiene checks and parameters which would become mandatory for all establishments and installations to have, so that, you know, we are ensuring the safety of all people traveling and visiting the country. So I think we should definitely use this opportunity and not look at it as a hindrance, but as an opportunity or a blessing in disguise for new things to come, for ways by which the industry is going to be reformed, and look at, you know, possibilities of ideas coming forward. Now, what I feel is that domestic tourism is number one that is going to lead the way. We are going to, we are looking at probably a few domestic tourist destinations, especially in the Himalayas and areas which have not been hit by COVID so much, opening up in the near future. Today, the Union Territory of Ladakh and Himachal Pradesh said that they should be looking at tourists coming in the next couple of months. The Northeast has relatively been not so impacted by COVID. In fact, Sikkim received its first COVID case only last week. So the Northeast has been relatively incubated from COVID. So this is a great opportunity for even the industry exploring tourism and travel related opportunities to the unexplored part of the country. As you know, the Ministry of Tourism has also started this online webinar series called as a Dekho Apna Desh, where they are having people, experts from different parts of the country coming and giving you visual social cases, where they've taken you on visual journeys across Ladakh, the Northeast, Uttarakhand, and so on. So the government also is having a huge impetus on promoting tourism, which is highly local, and to parts of the country which are not so mainstream. Now, I also believe that nature and wildlife tourism will be given a great boost post-COVID. People are going to be a little hesitant towards traveling to very, very crowded areas and places with a lot of people. So naturally, places with natural surroundings. So think of jungle safaris becoming very popular, nature treks, wildlife treks, retreats to areas which are abundant in nature. So look at something like taking a coffee trail probably in a coffee estate in Chittagong, or tea trails across tea estates of Ooty, Assam or Darjeeling, Kalimpong, all of these where there is huge, lots of nature, lesser people, so the risk of exposure is much lesser. This will create Philippines. Activity-based tours are something which will get very popular, something like cycling tours, treks, trails, kayaking, activities which are very immersive, where people have huge interaction with natural surroundings is something which I assume would again be very, very popular. In our experience with COVID, we have noticed that one is that the disease kind of spread in very heavily urban settlements. And the villages in the country, luckily, have been relatively unaffected by the disease. I get this as an opportunity for village-based tourism in different parts of the country where you can have an experience where people go and see what it is like to live the life of a local villager. I think the youth today, especially children or young adults, are very insulated and unexposed to what rural life is like. It's a great opportunity to use tourism as a teacher, wherein people get exposed to our roots, something like how does plantation happen? Or what is a day in a farm like? Or just spend a day with a local farmer in a remote village, maybe somewhere in South India, in the mountains, in the east. Each one of them is a unique culture and each one of them is a nature which is very, very unique and indigenous. We're very lucky in our country to be have blessed with so much of diversity that you travel a couple of kilometers, northwest, east, south, and you are exposed to a new culture. All of this needs to be packaged, promoted, and showcased to the rest of the world. Personally, for me, I'm very, very fond of Ladakh as a destination. Ladakh, for me, was something which is very dear to my heart, and I have done a lot of work with rural communities in Ladakh. And it is absolutely amazing to see how Ladakh as a state has started incorporating and implementing village-based rural tourism as a concept. So a lot of villages have identified a few homes which are being developed as designated homestays. So guests can come, stay in these village-based homestays and explore and experience what rural life is. Now, for people looking at entrepreneurship in travel, tourism, and hospitality, I think this is a great space to be in, where you could look at getting into the homestay network. Make connects. Let's look at developing tourism as an industry beyond our tier one cities. The real India, as what Gandhiji said, and I also believe, is the India of the villages. That is the true essence of India. That is the real India. And I think we need to be those people from the industry who showcase the real India to the rest of us in India and henceforth to people from around the world. Road trips, again, are something which I believe will gain a lot of popularity. For the time being, a lot of people would be a little skeptic about using public modes of transport, be it train, buses, or airlines, for the natural reason that the more you come in contact with, the risk of exposure being more. There is a scope here for road trips being a new quick thing which people would probably want to take, because a lot of people are itching to get out and go and explore a new place once the lockdown is lifted. So quick weekend getaways and weekend destinations are something which would be a trend which would gain a lot of popularity. For a lot of people who are in Andhra and Telangana, I keep stressing on this that we unfortunately do not have a lot of weekend destinations which are around us in the state. Something like if you look at Bangalore, Pune, Mumbai, urban centers, there are a lot of quick weekend destinations which are a quick 2 to 4 to 5 hour drive away. We unfortunately are not blessed with so much. So this is again an opportunity to develop infrastructure. Like, for example, if you look at something like a Gandikota or a Belem Caves, beautiful natural beauty, blessed with so much, some of the most unique natural formations in the country. We just need to develop the infrastructure around it. Just before the lockdown happened, I happened to visit Meghalaya. Meghalaya as a state wants to position itself as the adventure capital, adventure sports or adventure tourism capital of the country. So they have rock climbing, canoeing, bungee jumping. But what really piqued my interest there was caving. You would be interested to know and amazed to know that Meghalaya boasts of the largest and the longest underground cave network system in the world. Vikram Puri Cave, which is the longest limestone cave in the world, is 25 kilometers long and which has recently been discovered. Caving is a new adventure sport. It's also called as spelunking, which is something which is gaining a lot of popularity. Vietnam as a country has done a brilliant job with packaging caving for extreme adventure sports enthusiasts. We in India are blessed with Meghalaya as a state having caves as such. We need to just package this. So people who are looking at making careers in adventure tourism or people who are looking at joining adventure tour companies, I'm telling you, we have so much of it in this country. We need to package it and we need to showcase it to the world. I was fortunate enough to have gone on a caving expedition where we explored one of the caves. It's called the Sindai Cave. We explored only 5 kilometers. It took us about 2 hours to get in and out of the cave. The natural formations with the stalactites, stalagmites, it is a unique ecosystem by itself, the subterranean ecosystem as it is called. And I can guarantee you, if this is packaged well, you would get patrons all over the world who would want to come and explore what caves are. Closer home, we have the Belum Caves and a whole bunch of caves which are waiting to be packaged and explored across. Lastly, homestays. A lot of people might be a little skeptic towards staying at conventional hotels and maybe large chains because of the safety aspect. And also you don't know how many people have been coming in and out and interacting with you. The number of points of contact are going to be great. This is a great space for homestays to come in and capitalize and get themselves as safe options to stay. Homestays are small or small boutique properties can focus on the fact that there are very few people staying there. There is very little personal contact and interaction via which, the risk of exposure is largely reduced. Therefore, I feel homestays, it's a great opportunity to work on homestay networks. So just having homestays come and prevail. Then experiences. What is life but not a collection and conglomeration of a whole bunch of experiences? You know, everything we do today is an experience. Today, because of lockdown, visual experiences via the medium of technology have taken a prevalence. But once this is lifted, I'm sure people would want to come out and experience what life is, what nature is. So I believe that experience-based travel would prevail. Things, something like, as I talked about, cycling tours, kayaking tours, what about culinary tours where you explore the food and cuisine of a new destination that you visit? We as a country are blessed with so much of diversity when it comes to landscape and cuisine. Let's look at creating tours around that. Culinary tourism could be something which we can bring and showcase. Exploring the art, the dances, the different festivals, the indigenous festivals which are celebrated around the region. For example, Nagaland as a state has done a brilliant job with promoting the Hornbill Festival. The Hornbill Festival has been showcased as this lovely platform wherein we can see the diversity of Nagaland as a state that it has in terms of its tribes. I think we can look at this as an opportunity to promote local festivals in other regions. And it's a short incubation period, but if done right, we can have festivals happening all over the country at different points of time. And people would love to come and experience what this is. People would probably also look at taking smaller holidays. You know, large groups would be something which people would refrain for the small for the certain time being. So smaller holidays, smaller groups would be something which people would like to take. And that's also something which we as industry experts would need to modify ourselves to. So I'd like to close with this, and I hope the points which I have given are of value to you, and you have been taking notes. I encourage entrepreneurship, and I love ideas coming out for people to see how we can probably work and improve what things are in the tourism industry in the future. And on a closing note, I'd like to just read this out. There are many limits within our world, but one thing which knows no bounds is humanity's collective curiosity, our fidgety, irrepressible impulse to move, to discover and cross new frontiers, to adapt to new environments, to appease that same unquenchable curiosity which prompted our earliest ancestors to swing down from the treetops and start exploring the jungle floor 6 million years ago, is as strong as ever. And this will remain the insatiable thirst that only travel, exploring, and experiences will quench. So keep traveling, keep exploring, and I assure you all that this industry will bounce back, reformed, revived, and rejuvenated. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you, Ms. Vandana Chai. Thank you for your insights and discussing about the new forms of tourism, particularly in the context of a sustainable and a responsible or experiential tourism. Now we open for the questions from the students. If they have any questions, they can ask from the chat box. They can type there, so I can read it out. So as of now, we have a question. It is not particularly about career opportunities. It is in general to Vandana Madam. The question is how we promote ecotourism and conserve the environment for ecotourism.
Right. So ecotourism, as we talk about, is a form of tourism that incorporates the ecology of the area around it and does not disturb the natural surroundings around the region. So it is a very immersive form of tourism. How we promote ecotourism is very simple. Any country or any region which is culturally rich and looks at showcasing the culture, the diaspora, the diversity, which could be natural or man-made, can promote ecotourism. India as a nation, as we know, is blessed with so much of cultural diversity and landscape diversity. So it's very nice and easy for us to promote ecotourism. A lot of states are doing great job at this. If you look at Uttarakhand as a state, Himachal, the newly formed Union Territory of Ladakh, or a lot of states in the Northeast, they've done a brilliant job with promoting ecotourism. I'll give you an example of Nagaland here. Nagaland is a state, if you know, was formed in the 1960s. And if you look at the diaspora of the state, it is a conglomeration of various tribes. You've got over 26 different tribes, each one of them having a unique dialect, unique culture, cuisine, costume, and so on and so forth. So if you look at Nagaland state tourism, they have promoted this. They say, discover Nagaland, discover Naga. Nagaland is also called as the Wild East of India. So they have done a brilliant job by saying, when you're coming to Nagaland, you're not coming here to experience a mall or something which is very urban. You are coming here to experience what raw, rustic, authentically unique Naga life is. So that is how you need to promote ecotourism. Tourism, which is in sync with nature, which is not intrusive, and something which will come very naturally to you. Yeah. And that answers your question.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. So the next question from Priya Krishna Chakrabarti. The question is, in this situation where the tourism is very much affected with the novel coronavirus, so in this regard, how to convince the parents and the students to join tourism and hospitality courses? Maybe Hari Krishna sir or maybe Sira sir can answer this question.
Yeah. Is Siraj wants to answer? Okay, let me take this question. Okay, as a student, first you need to ask this question yourself. If you have passion towards the subject, what are the challenges outer world facing temporarily, that you have to remember. So if you are convinced, I'm sure you will convince anybody in the world. So convincing parents is not a difficult thing if you are convinced. If you are confused, then I'm sorry, you cannot convince your parents. But definitely as an institute, institute and stakeholders, we are trying our best, you know, to give you our knowledge and our challenges, what we undergone, but still we are expecting with a great hope. Imagine they're still paying the salaries to the employees with no income I'm getting for the past 4 months or 5 months. They're still taking care of our staff, but we're keeping the future in mind, keeping a hope in mind. So these are temporary turbulences. So if you think that this is the end of the world, then definitely you cannot get convinced, not only in the travel and tourism, any other sector you will find the same kind of challenges. So you have to accept first, you have to get convinced yourself first, then only you can convince parents or anybody. Thank you.
Yeah. The next question is from Muhammad Asifuddin. The question is, why we are failed to make tourism as an industry instead of a combination of sectors?
Yeah. Let me take this question. If you see any industry, a standalone product making or, you know, such kind of people, they're all under SMEs or industry sector. But unfortunately, tourism industry is services of ancillary services of different sectors, like airline guys providing air service. You have got car rentals, fleet management is a different owner. He's giving a car services. A tour guide is coming and, as a freelancer, he's serving as a, you know, tour guide, and a hotelier comes from a hotel industry separately. So these are all different ancillary services all put together, combined under one umbrella, is called tourism. So that's why it is not classified, unfortunately, as a tourism industry. But we all stakeholders are fighting very hard, raising our voice to the government of India to consider tourism as an industry, because our contribution towards the GDP is high. Our employment source, there's a second biggest employer in the world is travel and tourism and hospitality. So still government is under consideration, but I'm sure one day we will win this. But definitely it's a high time to recognize tourism as an industry. That's a wonderful question raised by you. Thank you.
Yeah, the next question we have from Jainab. The question is, how can we build a career in culinary tourism? Is there any specialized course that we can do? And you know, the participant is basically done MBA in tourism and travel management. Yeah. Yeah, please.
Sirat sir, would you want to take that, or can I take this?
Yeah, please.
All right. So, there are no specialized courses, honestly, which are required to build a career in culinary tourism. Giving you my background, I don't have a degree in tourism. I have a master's in microbiology. I wanted to join the army after that. I came All India first in merit, then went on to work in Facebook, and here I am. So I think what is most important is a burning passion, a curiosity. To answer your question more specifically, culinary tourism essentially involves tours and activities where you are sightseeing a place, but the main focus is the food. So what I would suggest is identify a particular region and do a thorough in-depth study on the cuisine from a very cuisine perspective of the region. For example, let's look at Bhutan as a destination. Bhutan is a country which has done a brilliant job again with experience-based travel and focusing and promoting their indigenous culture. So when you have culinary tourism Bhutan, it will start with something simple as taking you to local farmers. So the experience is called as a farm-to-table experience, where you visit the fields or you visit areas where raw produce, like a farmer's market, and you understand what the basic food and components are. Then you come to a chef. It could be a home chef, or it could be a gourmet chef at a restaurant. It could be a Michelin star chef if you're looking at culinary tourism in a particular city. And then interact with you and talk to you about what the food of the region is. Why is the particular crop grown in a particular region? For example, barley is very popular as a staple in the higher Himalayas, where rice and wheat does grow. So that is why people would have buckwheat and barley with rotis and grain, whereas people in the plains or in southern India, as we see, rice is a staple. So there's a huge ecological and environmental factor which is responsible to the culinary and food habits of the region. So when you're looking at focusing and starting on culinary tourism, I would suggest is have an in-depth knowledge of the region you are trying to promote. Curate specialized, detail-oriented, bespoke tours, which could be something as small as a few hour-based experience or a tour lasting for a couple of days. Curate that. Now you have a lot of platforms on which you can advertise this also. So you have something where it's a Netherlands-based company called as Book Culinary Vacation, which only focuses on culinary tours around the world. Airbnb is doing Airbnb experiences, which are again based, and you can put culinary tours or that. Or you have another company called as Authenticook, which is again doing food-based experiences around the country. So the platforms are many on which you can advertise, but my focus would be is first work on your product. Your product should be unique. Your product should be full of detail, and product should be something that people around the world would take interest in. And then reaching out to people is just a matter of time. and persistence.
Oh, thank you. Further, I'd like to join up to attend one more session we have planned in the tour hospitality. Maybe you can attend that program for more information or insights in this particular area. Next, we have a question from Niharika, and the question is there any difference between sustainable and ecotourism? I think this question is also again to Vandana Madam. Is there any difference between sustainable and ecotourism?
Niharika, I think both kind of blend into each other, and I think sustainable tourism is the way forward. I think everybody in the tourism industry, domestically or internationally, is talking about tourism being sustainable. If you look at the United Nations has the SDGs, sustainable tourism is one of them. As Valmiki ji said, tourism and hospitality is an industry. It's one of the largest employers in the world. In India, 38% of the workforce is employed in tourism and hospitality related industries. 10% of the national GDP is contributed by our industry. So it is imperative that this has to grow, and it will grow in a sustainable format. Ecotourism is a means by which we can promote sustainable tourism, which is holistic, which is inclusive, and does not harm nature. It is not exploitative. It is a very immersive means. So I think how I'd like to put it is sustainable travel is the overarching umbrella, and ecotourism is one of the means by which we can achieve sustainable tourism.
Thank you, madam. Next question we have from Baby. The question is how to convince overseas people in current situation, and which is best places to see in India. Maybe Siraj sir can answer.
Well, the reality factors, how to convince is the very important aspect, because you have to give the proper information to the concerned people, and I'm sure that is what is going to really make them to accept the fact. Now the tourism aspect is to be more focused only on the domestic segment. Those who are concerned about safety measures and all that, they are restricted only to domestic tourism, at least for a couple of months now in India. And that is going to enhance the tourism business also for the domestic segment. But as far as international concern is, it takes some time for it to cope up with it. And we should probably request our people to come forward and take the initiative. And taking initiative only, they're going to give a confidence for people to travel from different places into India. If you're looking for more focus on the inbound tourism, this is one area where it will take some time for people to come into India. But of course, if you focus only on our national citizens of our nation, yes, we have a good opportunities. We can explore various regions where people will be very convinced on that aspect.
Yeah, thank you, sir. The next question is from Anam Rahman. The question is, what are the marketing strategies need to be adopted at this time to promote the tourism and hospitality industry?
Let me answer this.
Yeah, please, sir.
Definitely the marketing strategy need to be changed quite often depending upon the situation. Today, because of this COVID situation, we need to avoid advertisements like newspaper ads, because newspapers are banned almost going house to house. Then the advertisements and the hoardings are also stopped almost, because people are stuck at home at stay at home concept. So where you can advertise and still attract the eye contact of customer is digital media. So today and the present and future is more on the digital media. So when you contact the social media like Facebook, Twitter, and so many other platforms, there is an advertisement facility available, WhatsApp, and even the television. These are the areas which you can pick up and start sending. The big chain of hotels are started already sending small AVs, 1 minute videos, attracting customers that we are already geared up to give you the safety measurement, especially healthy point of view, to convince customer. So gone are those days, you want to see the kitchen first. Now kitchen cannot be entered by a common man now. So there's so many things they're going to adopt and say, making advertisement and sending through AVs and through the WhatsApp and other areas. So the best way, the future is digital marketing.
Okay, thank you, sir. Any questions from the participants?
Can I ask one question?
Yeah.
Is it audible?
Yes.
Yeah, unfortunately, I can I cannot on my video. I will go with
the audio. Yeah, please.
Hi all, this is Mohammad Asif. The question is like everything is good. We have the moral support. We can be we can get to cover ladder. We can start again. It's a second inning for all the travel agents and the tour operators. It's fine. That is okay. But what about the online finance like Make My Trip kind of companies? They are looting the market, like they are killing the market by reducing the flight cost. If you purchase the same ticket in the direct airlines, it is different. When you go with the Make My Trip, it is completely different. That means they are giving a coupon, such kind of, they have created something, a promotional creations, whereas they are killing the airline, like then complete, no travel agent can sell airline fare better than Make My Trip, like that companies. So my question to this TOAT, TOT, or else IATA company, what they are doing? Why they are not insisting these companies? Why they are not complaining these companies? Why they are not getting the barrier to such kind of company? Because we as the travel agents are sitting to earn at least some income. But what they are doing by decreasing the airfare, automatically the other sectors, if we add, the total cost will be getting down. If they are getting 15% is also, they are collecting a huge amount in the normal package. But whereas the normal tour operator can't do it. So you people have to focus on it. Why don't you people are focusing on this? Why are you people are not raising on this?
I'll answer that question to you. That's a good question we asked. Well, frankly speaking, this has been going since last 4 years. Our association of TOAT has been very extensively trying to reach out to many people to advise them to not to promote or recommend online portals. But unfortunately, what happens is every client, every other person in the sideline tries to make some additional revenue or try to cope up with the very devastating market situation now. So I think the online portals have been selling in losses. We have a lot of information.
I have the answer, sir. I have the answer. Yeah. I have researched personally. I worked for the Make My Trip earlier.
Very good. Okay.
So during the work time, I researched parallelly why these people are giving lowest than the actual airline company. So I came to know that when the time of booking, they are mentioning a clear form that in cancellations, whatever the refunds, they are giving in a different tariffs, not for the actuals.
Yes.
So for example, if you are getting a 10,000 amount from the airline, but they are giving only 2,000 to you. Rest of the 8,000, they are investing to promote their products. So in that manner, they are facilitating the people. So this is not at all good thing.
Yeah, I'll just share a few more information. If you see the reality of the online portals, 20% of that revenue, what they get is from the cancellation charges. And besides this point, if you see the realistic aspect is most of the travel agents trying to ensure that they get a better deal. But with a better deal is at the cost of a risk factor. When you do with the authorized travel companies, you have an advantage that when any other client decides to cancel his flights, he gets his flight amount refundable back to him. Because we issue most of the refundable tickets. But when you do an online portal, there's no question of refund coming in. Second,
have their own terms.
Yes, they have their own terms and conditions. Second thing is, the most important thing is the clients realize that when you call up an online portal now, and again you call after 5 minutes, there's another person picking up the call. And you have to brief them the entire situation to them. And claiming a refund is a big task for them. But when you deal with a travel company, you have an advantage. The person is able to respond to you instantly. He's able to give you a proper support to you. And let me tell you one simple thing is when you book a ticket online and you travel to go to any destination, you land in the airport and you realize the flight is canceled. And what happens that time? The airline says, please claim for the refund. And the refund takes more than 2 weeks to 3 weeks to get back into your account. But if you do with a travel company, the advantage is he gives you an alternate flight instantly for you. And that's what the one-to-one relationship which we are trying to emphasize to most of our clientele. Learn to help people, help each other. So if you're going to someone's giving a quality service to you, there's some sort of nominal charges to be paid. When you don't think about paying a service fee to the respective travel companies, but you are bound to give enormous of amount on the taxation. That is something which is very insensible. I've been telling a lot of people on this. Just think wisely how you can be mutual support. And when it comes to online portal, yes, I strongly agree to the fact is they have spoiled the industry very badly. And but that's the reason why we emphasize all the travel companies should use portals which have been recommended by the travel fraternity. We have various portals like GRN Connect, we have GTS, we have a lot of other companies which are giving exclusive deals and good services. But online, I don't recommend. But now thing is, the technology has become so advanced, everyone in the phone is accessible to reservations. That makes things easier for people to go and book flights or book the thing. But booking a tour package is not that easy. Ticketing, yes, I agree. Yes, online portals have really swept the market. But when it comes to tourism aspect, it still it lags behind. Because in, for tourism, we have so many components related to it. Your hotels, your car rentals, your greeting services, your flight tickets, your visas. These things are very essential aspects which online portals cannot give it so personalized what a travel company can give for you. So that's what I feel. You guys are the aspiring travel agents. You are a good brand ambassador for the industry. You have to gear up, gain wonderful knowledge, get the right resources, make sure that you give a tough time for the online portals. Because the industry, everyone goes in the same direction. They get, you know, swayed by the same way. But if you want to think different, then this is the right time to do. We have to start from the beginning now. And that's what I feel that you guys have a good opportunity. You have a wonderful team to support you in Nitin. Plus, you have such you know, eminent personalities of the industry before you on the screen, right? So I think Hari Krishan and Vandana and Mr. I would say Mr. Chinnam has very been supportive to the industry. So I think that answers the question. Just be patient. We would definitely refine the industry in a much better way. And a lot of freelancers will be eliminated from the industry.
Can I just add that?
Yes.
Yeah, please, madam.
So if you look at countries where digital penetration is a lot more than India, very developed economies, like you can look at UK or USA, you know, despite having so much internet penetration, the offline travel agent market and the tour agent market is still existing because there is this trust factor which is there. There is a face, there is a person. We are in an industry, it's all where we're building, it's about building relationships. So we are here to stay. This will happen no matter what it is. We just need to modify ourselves, tweak our narrative, and present ourselves out there saying that, you know, we as individuals are going to be with you, hold your hand, come what may, no matter which corner of the world you are, which kind of personalization the online industry cannot offer.
Okay, thank you. Next, we have a question from Vishal. And the question, before, you know, the question he gave, you know, his opinion that I see there is no scope for international tourism for at least 2022. And inbound tourism, I think there won't be any travel until this fall. So in this regard, the question is, so what do we do in this time and what can the opportunity be?
Can I answer this?
Yeah, please, sir.
Okay. Mr. Vishal, yes, you rightly pointed out 1 year or maybe 6 to 8 months, it will definitely take international borders to open and fully secured and people start traveling. By then, vaccine will be in place. But till such time, what we do inbound also cannot be done because Indian borders are not yet open for foreigners to come for the leisure. Only domestic tourists will pick up very big way. Every country is going to focus in their own domestic tourists now. So India by road, as Vandana already pointed out, by road travel will increase a very big way. So people will start traveling within India. As Prime Minister Narendra Modi already mentioned that every common Indian should must visit the 50 destinations within India. So now it's an opportunity for you to time and expertise, to identify as a mini world. World is in India, if you ask me, whether you need a desert you can see in India, whether you need ocean, whether you need ice environment, maybe, you know, going to Kashmir, you know, there are so many wonders within India itself available. We always try to admire far away is greenery. Even today people say Switzerland is beautiful, but you know, when you come to our own Himalayas in the Jammu Kashmir, you know, you will really find better, happiness than what you have done there. But only thing is, yes, they are well equipped, certain areas to lure the, the customers. So now in this period, domestic travel will definitely pick up in a big way. maybe the airfare will go up because of the social distancing in matter. 38% of the flight capacity to forego without selling those seats should be kept as empty. So remaining 62% of flight capacity, if they want to sell, actually on an average to airlift an aircraft, they need 77% of the aircraft to be sold, then only they can reach a break even. Now you are talking about 38% not to fill the seats. 62% is the flight is still on a lower side when it comes to operate. So they will definitely hike up the fares, anything between 15% to 30% to 35% airfares. Then only they will be able to cope up, and the flights will start as resuming, because even the aviation ministry is interested to give a green nod, but state to state understanding is still not yet, because some states which are heavily affected COVID, they don't want flights to come from that destination to another destination. So these all are part of the game now. In a short span of time, this will be sorted out, but road travel will pick up a lot. So you can be busy with engaging travelers within India traveling by road. Thank you.
There is a question from Srinath. You would like to ask Vandana, madam. Mr. Srinath, you are welcome to ask.
Hello, ma'am. Very good afternoon.
Yeah, the question is to Vijay. Okay.
Ma'am, I'm following you since your inception of Off-Beat Track. And I had made few models also, depends how you are dealing with the market and all. So by the way, I had asked you a few questions on the chat. I would like to know, what are the new measures to be taken in terms of hospitality trainings at rural tourism sites in this new normal period? And how should we approach, what are the new approaches to be followed towards potential markets? And how to make people safe in the rural environments? Because now we are into a new period. It's not like earlier before. So is it how feasible we can do this? And how can we make people trust on these sort of sites? And I would like to know from you.
Could you just elaborate on your last one? You say how to make people trust on sites? I'm sorry, I didn't quite get that.
Sites in, ma'am, yes. You work in Ladakh and Bhutan as well. And in a very rural areas.
That's right.
Where, people are a different set of people who really love to spend in their times in those places. Now, as earlier, Siraj sir and Valmiki sir said, the star hotels, they had trained their staff. They had doing some digital marketing to approach the markets, like people that they are safe. The stay with them is safe now from, in this new period. When it comes to rural sites where there are barely the, basic amenities available, still people love to the unique experiences. In those cases, how we can make them, how can we ensure them that these places are pretty safe than the others, and you can come and visit, spend your time, help the local, community. This is like to know.
In fact, I think it's probably going to be on the flip side. At this point of time, if you look at people in rural areas or people from different parts of the country, they are more scared of having people from urban areas come to visit them, because they are scared that we will bring infection to them versus, them being safe and things. So I think on that side of it, from our vendors, in fact, and that's a conversation which I am having with a lot of my vendors in remote areas, where they're like, our area is relatively been unexposed and we have been in a silo and we've not had exposure. So we are very apprehensive about getting people in who are especially coming from urban centers where the prevalence of the infection was very high. So that's something. But of course, that is for the time being till, we figure out how to mitigate and combat the effect of this virus. Eventually, I think what happens is narratives need to be woven, messages need to be sent out, information needs to be sent out. When you're talking about safety has a lot of parameters. COVID is one now, because that is trending. But let's look at other aspects of safety. a huge growing number of people traveling today are women travelers. We have women traveling as solo women travelers or in groups. You see statistics wise also, a lot of women are forming a huge component of our travel market. Now, when I get people here, this is what I tell them. There is probably no place safer in the country for a solo woman to travel than probably to somewhere remote in the mountains or the Northeast. Primarily, the social setup of the East is such that societies are very matriarchal or matrilineal, because of which women enjoy very good social status and position in societies, thereby making it very safe for them to travel. So inherently, if you look at nature of crime-wise, in terms of statistics and all of that, a lot of these parts of India, which are rural or parts where we are trying to promote the concept of rural ecotourism, are very, very safe. So just in terms of safety for your life or in terms of exposure to viruses and all of this, because this pandemic essentially came in from abroad, and then and these regions of the country are very have been very, very undisturbed and not exposed to the rest of the country. So this is not something which is of major concern. I think the reverse, where we need to sensitize our vendors, saying that, you know, people who come and stay with you are going to be checked and we will assure you that they are healthy, safe people, not bringing infection into you, is something which is which would be needed to be addressed more.
Great. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you. Maybe we'll take a last question. One question. The question is from Deepin. The question is, do we have the infrastructure needed to experience this boom expected in domestic circuit? Also, can we compete with the tourism experience that's provided by countries abroad, even though we have a better landscape available?
Yes. You want me to answer that, or?
Yeah, of course, you can. You can. Yes.
Okay. See, I just happened to highlight to you that we couldn't be focused more on domestic tourism, and India has a wonderful opportunity. But unfortunately, we were not much focused because of various diversions in terms of political aspects. But invariably, I see that there's a lot of scope and potential in the domestic tourism now. And if we can just identify the wonderful destinations which are pan-India, I think that is the best way to promote tourism. We have another new concepts are going to be enhanced now. Very soon it's going to come in. And that is going to help many people to come to India. I assure you one thing is we would have many people who are going to focus on medical tourism. We're going to do on rural tourism and many scopes of aspects of health options which are available in tourism. That is going to be explored now. And that is going to give a better opportunity for those who are residents of our nation to get into this hospitality and tourism industry also.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you all. Before closing, I would like to invite our director, sir, Dr. S. Chinnamareddy Garu, to say a few words about this particular program and also about the speakers.
Thank you, Mr. Siraj ji, and Dr. Mr. Arikishan ji, and Ms. Vandana Garu, and for talking, clearing a lot of concepts regarding the travel and tourism. I also strongly believe that this is only temporary and we should not too much worry about this corona and all sort of things like that. And I'm sure that this is going to, going to in a very big boom is going to come in the tourism. Maybe it may take 6 months or maybe it may take 9 months here. But I'm sure that when this vaccine comes here, I think everything will become normal. So I think thank you once again on the behalf of Nitam for all these participants also for wonderfully listening here, and taking a lot of learning from this thing.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Before closing the session, I would like to ask you all to, have a group photo. I request you all to, just put namaste. You know, this is what we are generally doing. Okay.
I don't get to see any of them here. Have everyone come online? I mean, everyone is on the screen.
Yeah.
But 61 participants.
Namaste. Yeah,
can't see most of them.
Namaste.
Yeah, now I can see. Yes, that's good.
I hold with one hand with my phone, so I can't able to put namaste.
Okay, that's not a problem. If you feel it, that's, you know.
You can salute. You can salute.
Let me thank Mr. Chinnam. He has taken a wonderful opportunity to motivate his students, and he has a wonderful team with him. I think get to see Mr. Naren there. I don't know where is the other people. I don't get to see them.
Yet. Everyone is here, sir. Everyone is here.
Yes, Lakshmikant. Yes, Lakshmikant. I can see him. Yes, yes. Okay. Yadgiri. Okay. Very good. Where's Michelle? Yeah. Is not to be seen here.
Michelle, ma'am, is there. She's there.
Okay, and another person is also there. Okay. Good.
Okay. We have taken the. Thank you, one and all. Particularly, you know, the today's session speakers. Mr. Vandana Vijay and Mr. Visiraj Ansari and Mr. Valmiki Harikishan, sir. So this is a great opportunity for our students to have your opinion, and particularly about the industry and their particularly clarifying their doubts about the career perspectives in tourism. So once again, thank you all, particularly for your patience, and the participants also. I thank on behalf of Nitim for your participation in this particular program. Thank you.
I have a suggestion, Mahendra.
Yes, please.
Yeah, bataiye.
I suggest, since I think most of the people are just set back now, just to make them more active, we would have a session for entire students of Nitim and those other people who would know about the future technology for the tourism aspect. We could have one session coming soon. Probably June 1st, sure. Week, second week, we can do that.
Yeah. Sure, we'll do. Definitely, we'll do that. We'll plan it now.
Sure.
Okay.
Can I ask one question, sir?
Only one question?
Maybe you can ask.
Sir, one thing, sir, that when you, are you going to get any certificate for this one? And second one is, do you get a recording of this one, sir?
Yes, sir. You have both certificate and recording. You will.
Thank
get
you. One. Thank you. Keep posting on, sir.
It will be uploaded to the YouTube. You can able to watch there. Fine. And second, the certificate will send it to you by email, actually. This was
thank you very much.
Yeah, you can follow our social media, whatever, Facebook or Instagram. Fine. Everywhere we'll upload this particular video.
Thank you.
Even on YouTube also, as our directors have said. Thank you all once again. And thanks to our director, Dr. Chinnam Reddy Garu, for giving this particular wonderful opportunity.
National Institute of Tourism and Hospitality Management. Nurturing excellence, serving success.